Any society is having poor as well as richest. The traders and the trader dynasties, they were very rich during Gupta Empire. Usually in the cities in Gupta Empire, they are considered as non-agriculturist cities. So Pura, Nagara, like that, they are having mentioned. Even Rajdhani, that is also non-agriculturist part. So there, this type of traders, they were settled usually at the central part of cities. They were staying in huge houses similar to palace, well decorated and luxurious houses they were using. But at the same time, at outskirts of cities, the poor, they were living, and their condition was not good. So as we can say that in any society, the rich people are there because poor are there. So like that, we can say that here the society was composed of all these things. But what is the main part? That the beginning of casteism. In ancient society, casteism was not prominent. I am not saying that no casteism was there, but casteism was not prominent in ancient Indian society. But during Gupta period, the casteism became prominent. Various reasons we can give at that time. Majoritily, the foreign invaders, like we had discussed, Scythians, Kushan, major invaders we are discussing, but in actual practice, Shak, Kushan, Abhir, Parthar, Darad, and so on, the foreigners were coming in India. Most of them were accepting Hinduism, and Hinduism is without caste, not possible. So they were accepting certain caste. Majority rulers, they accepted Kshatriya as their class. And so the racial purity question was the problem. At that time, Vaishya, they were carrying out interbreeding. Inter-caste marriages were popular in Vaishya caste, and because of that, it is given in certain books that thousands of new castes, because of this mixing, was produced during that period. So thousands of castes were produced in that period, whereas in old days, Manusmriti gives very less, somewhat 64 mixed caste. So that is the difference here. May be possible because of that, caste system must have evolved, or rigidity is maintained in caste system. The maintaining this rigidity was started from Gupta period, what probably we can say. The position of woman also start declining in Gupta Empire. She was not having right on property except Stri Dhana. Other all property was belonged to male, so male dominancy was observed over here. So position of woman start declining. It is not having evidence, but we can believe that practice of sati become prominent in this period. I am not saying started, because just go through Mahabharata. When Pandu, the father of Pandav, expired, he was having two wives, Kunti and Madri. Madri accepted for sati, and she was just birthed by her own will, whereas Kunti was not followed this practice. So this is the thing that was optional, that one can accept or one cannot accept. But in Gupta period, it is believed that the practice of sati, especially during northern India, that become prominent. So position of women start declining in this particular era. Then religions. Society was having main religion as Hinduism. As we have discussed, Gupta era, that is golden era for Hinduism, or rather historians are saying about Brahmanism. So that was golden era for Brahmanism. So Brahmanism was prominent. The Buddhism was also there. Jainism and to some extent Christianity. No doubt Christianity was there only in Malabar coast, that is South India, Kerala. So on the Kerala coast, Christianity was there. That was not part of Gupta Empire at that time. And remaining all three religions, that means Hinduism, Buddhism and Jainism, they were survived. But the things that whatever we are following Hinduism today, that idolatry must have prominent during Gupta period. The Hindu society or Hindu religion was shaped in Gupta Empire, whereas certain advancements were carried out in Buddhism also. And historians are saying because of these advancements, Buddhism declined out. So certain changes were carried out in Buddhism, resulting declination of Buddhism, whereas Jain, as Jainism is religion of traders, they continued to trade and they were not in a position to accept new things, and so they get survived. So Jainism was remained as it is, not flourished nor declined. Buddhism declined. The main reason we can say here, the declining nature of Buddhism, that lies number one, as rulers were patron of Hinduism, they restricted the grants for Buddhism. That is the important reason that Buddhism was not able to flourish, because the grants were not there for Buddhism in Gupta Empire. And second, may be possible with new techniques, say for example that sacrifice that was replaced by bhakti movement, the worship of God, making idol of God, keeping it at center of the temple and carrying out worship rather than sacrifice. So this change must have accepted by many people, and that's why maybe possible people must have converted from Buddhism to Hinduism. So this is also a possible thing. So all these religions survived. Now Hinduism, it is shaped majoritarily in this period, and we have to discuss now certain parts. Say for example, the first thing, that certain non-Aryan concepts were introduced in Hinduism. As historians are saying, this non-Aryan concept, may be possible they want to say tribal concept. As India was divided into tribal part, and this tribal also accepted Hinduism, may be possible they have introduced their concept over here as the worship of deity, that male and female deity, both, like Shiva and Parvati, Vishnu and Lakshmi. So like that, practices were carried out in Hinduism during Gupta Empire. The second thing, that Shaktism or Shakta Sampradaya, the sect that is called as Shakt, that was also become prominent during this part. They believe that male alone are not having any power. When combined with female, they are having power. And so the coupled worship, like as we have discussed, Vishnu and Lakshmi, Shiva and Parvati, or other manifestations. So that was prominent. Another thing, that as tribal communities entered here, they carried out their own things, and with help of Atharva Veda, from Aryan concept and this tribal concept, a sect is formed that is called as Tantrism. They believe in 5M, in Sanskrit, Madhya, Mausa, Meena, Maithuna, Mrugaya. That means one should consume alcohol always. This is not advisable obviously, but they believe that Madhya is essential, that means the wine that is essential. Mouse gives pleasure. Mean, that means fish. Mouse means meat. So meat, fish, maithun, that is sex, and mrugaya, that is hunting. These are purusharth, and one should carry out that. And they carried out worship of the, no doubt, of God, but they followed this type of way and some other path. I'm not familiar with that. They are called as Tantrism. So here, Tantrism also starts. Surprisingly, certain mixings you can also find that in Brahmanism, the concept of Shakti entered over here from Tantrism. Then in Buddhism, concept of Tara, and Jainism, concept of Yakshini, that was entered from Tantrism. Now, we are again concentrating on Hindu religion. As earlier we had discussed about Hindu religion, about that was about Vedic society. Now, in latter period, certain other philosophy that was also developed, that is no doubt Hindu philosophy. But we have to discuss in somewhat detail, then you will be able to understand six systems of Hindu philosophy. Keep in mind that these systems, we don't have a sure shot origin. Say for example, Nyaya Darshan system, that is called as Darshan Vangma actually. Darshan means what? Reveals. So here, Nyaya. Nyaya, that is giving logic. So here, it is believed that from Ashtapada Gautama, this school or say Darshan is there. According to that, whatever things are going on, each one will have some logic. And one should get right knowledge of that logic. So this is basic aim, that salvation can be attained by right knowledge. So that is given by Nyaya Darshan. The second Darshan, that is Vaisheshik Darshan. Vaisheshik Darshan was given by Rishi actually, named as Aulukya. According to this Aulukya, everything in this universe is made up of particles. Particles are made up of smaller particles and ultimately atoms. So the concept of atom was given over here. Now surprisingly, in Sanskrit, that atom or smaller particle, that is having word Kana. And so he was honored as by saying Kanad. So he is famous as Kanad, but the name is Aulukya from Uluk. He is termed as Aulukya. Now, according to this philosophy, there is no presence of God. Ved, etc. No. They are having idea that everything is matter, that is Dravya, that is made up of particles and particles. These atoms are combined to form molecule, and so that the world is manifestation of these all atoms and molecule. So this is the philosophy. This is basically Nastic. Nastic means not accepting the Vedic part, or usually God or this philosophy is not accepted, then that is called as Nastic. So this is Nastic Tatvajnan, Nastic philosophy, that is the Aulukya. Now this is more with logical, with science. But the presence of God and Atma, and so that the concepts are added and the philosophy is diluted. Sankhya. This philosophy is very old philosophy. Even in Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan Sri Krishna gives about this Sankhya. So according to this Sankhya Darshan, they are preferring Prakriti. Prakriti means nature, rather than God. They are saying that God is not creating out the world itself. Prakriti was there, that means nature was there. In 4th century AD, a concept Purusha, Purusha means not male, the soul, that was our spirit, that was added, and together with spirit and nature, the universe is made up. According to this philosophy, salvation can be attained by right knowledge. Again, everywhere knowledge word is very, very important. So right knowledge we should have. That can be achieved by fasting? No. That can be achieved by real knowledge, by getting inference. Whatever the facts we have, by analyzing that, we have to acquire knowledge, and that will give us salvation. So this is about Sankhya Darshan. Then fourth, that is Yoga Darshan, the Yoga system. again, origin is there in Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavan Sri Krishna says that yoga and Sankhya both are important for him. Now here yoga, it is formulated practically in modern days by Patanjali. Modern days means whenever historical period starts, that is. And according to Yoga Darshan, by giving right knowledge, one can attend for that yoga. The yogasana and yoga, they are different. Asana is one part, whereas yoga is another part. So we have to follow, that is called as yam, niyam, certain rules and regulations we have to follow. And we have to acquire knowledge and acquire salvation by carrying out this yoga technique. And many people believe that one should not speak out this. Now do not carry out publicity of this. We have to take own experience, whatever is going on. For more detail about this yoga, I will suggest you to read a very nice book. Actually, one who can explain about yoga, that is yogi himself. He can able to explain. And in order to get really good knowledge about yoga, I will suggest here English book, that is Autobiography of Yogi, given by Shri Shri Paramahansa Yogananda. So you can refer out this book. I am revising the name, that is Autobiography of Yogi by Shri Shri Paramahansa Yogananda. So you can check out this book to get right knowledge at Vigansi. Now next one, that is the Mimamsa. Mimamsa is actually analysis or reasoning. In old days, somewhere 6th century BC, Jaimini is the name of philosopher of this Mimamsa. Everything happens here because of some reason is there. Mimamsa flourished in 6th century AD under Savarkar. They believe in the Veda. The eternal truth is there in Veda. And we have to carry out sacrifice, whatever the given in Veda, that we have to follow. And then we are having salvation. So this is the basic idea of Mimamsa. The last one, that is the Vedanta, given by Badarayan. So Vedanta, that is also called as Uttara Mimamsa. So this philosophy believes in Veda. In 9th century, Shankara, that we are calling Adi Shankaracharya or Adya Shankaracharya, and in 12th century AD, Ramanujan, established and practiced out this Vedanta philosophy. Shankaracharya established 4 mathas, that means their ashram, all over the directions of India. Like in South India, the ashram was there in Sringeri, it is there in Karnataka. So the Shakti Pitha or ashram or math, that was there in Sringeri in South. In West India, the math was there in Dwarka, math is there in Dwarka. East India, Puri. And North India, Badrinath. So this way, 4 math, revised: North India, Badrinath; West India, Dwarka; East India, Puri; and South India, Sringeri. So these 4 ashram or 4 math, they are important. According to this Vedanta, one should have right knowledge, the Jnana Marg. And that Jnana or right knowledge, that lies in the statement in Ved, rather Upanishad, that is Aham Brahmasmi, that myself, I am Brahma. Brahmaiva Satyam Jagan Mithya. Only Brahma is the truth. All this universe, world, whatever, that is just unreal thing. Whatever the mithya, that is unreal, or we can say changing. Like that statements are there. So one should have right knowledge about that. Now this is not a spiritual classroom. And so we are just giving just idea that philosophy, the name, etc. But in detail, you can refer out, you can go for translations of this Upanishad, the Vedanta philosophy, very interesting to know. You can go directly over there. So this is about the six systems in Hindu society. Just you can take out these systems over here. The Vedanta, no doubt, I have written here, Badarayana, but later on, Shankaracharya and Ramanuja. Now, Bhagavad Gita. This is very, very important. As we are saying, this is holy book or sacred book for Hinduism. No doubt that accordingly we can say, but the original Hinduism should be there from Veda. Like other religions, say for example Muslim, they believe in that Holy Quran, or Christians believe in Bible. Like that, no single book is there to explain what is Hinduism. But in order to tell something, we are calling that Bhagavad Gita. But if you are accepting Bhagavad Gita as book for Hinduism, then certain questions are always there. Where Ram was Hindu or not? Because first Ramayana and then Mahabharata. So whether Ram was Hindu or not, and like that questions we can always ask. And so keep in mind that Bhagavad Gita, that is no doubt religious book, very, very important book. Now Bhagavad Gita is more concerned with action. It implies the mortality of body, immortality of soul, and whatever actions in present life, whatever actions we can carry out, that is important, rather than discussing whatever the truth and false. Instead of that, more practical approach was given in Bhagavad Gita. No doubt that duties are explained in nice way, but this is explained, the Bhagavad Gita, that is explained on the battlefield. To Vedic ideology, a person at time of birth only is liable for three types of loans. That loan, Sanskrit word is rana. So three types of loan a person is having, that is pitru rana, the loan of parents, celestial loan, that means deva rana, and society loan, that is samaja rana. And everybody's duty that we have to get freed from this type of loans. For example, by serving properly with our parents, we can escape from this pitru rana, that is the parental loan. Then by performing sacrifice and other rituals, we can be freed from deva rana, that is the celestial loan. And lastly, by giving a part of our work to society, or by offering services to this society, helping poor and others, we can get freed from this society loan or samaja rana. So this type of ideology was there, helpful for the society. Apart from that, another philosophy that is called as non-Vedic or say Nastic, that type of philosophy that was developed around 8th century BC. The exact reason and person is not known, this philosophy is called as Charvaka philosophy. Many people say that Charvaka is name of Rishi, and few are there, they are saying this is not the name of Rishi or sage. Simply, it is the materialistic thinking or materialistic ideology. That means consume here and live here. Like that ideology was there. So no Charvaka was there. This is name given to the ideology. This was also called as Lokayata. Now, what is the basic principle of this Charvaka or Lokayata? As we have discussed earlier, out of four Purusharatha, that is Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha, forget of first Dharma and forget of last Moksha. So in only thing, Artha and Kama, these two Purusharatha, one should follow. they are having three schools of thinking. The first school, that is called as Pratyaksha or Pratyakshavad. That means whatever we can give evidence only, that we have to accept. Say for example, there is heaven. Do you have any evidence for heaven? Now modern days you can say yes, because we are searching out new and new worlds. Variety of planets are discovered now. They are apart from our solar system, and our ideology now can expand. We can consider that concepts of Swarga, that means heaven, and hell also. Some planets must be there, but we don't have till today also evidence that there is heaven and there is hell. Or according to certain Puran, different types of hells are there and different types of heavens are also there. So like that, but we don't have evidence. Then what about the previous incarnations, the previous birth? We don't have evidence that there is memory. Forget of previous birth, think of this birth only. Just try to memorize whatever there happened with you when you were there around 1 year old. Try to recollect from 0 to 1 year old. Try to recollect. Even we'll not have memories what happened in those days. Obviously, by certain techniques of yoga that can be evoked. But here, the Charvaka ideology is saying this way, that there is no evidence of Swarga, that means heaven, as well as hell. Whatever the thing, that Atma, we should have evidence. So, this without evidence, we are not able to accept that there is heaven, hell, then rebirth and so on. So basically, they were saying that whatever the thing, they are having evidence, we can infer, take out inference, then only we have to accept the thing, otherwise don't accept. The second thing, they are giving Sukhavadu. Sukha means pleasure. So why we are coming on earth? We have to take pleasure of this. So take pleasure, whatever you want, you can carry out. Even it is argued, not in given in Charvaka ideology, but the commentators argue this way, that take out loan, but consume ghrita. Ghrita means ghee. So consume ghee by taking loan also, because whatever is here, that is here only. We are not able to take out anything from this, and there is no life practically above or beyond this earth. So whatever is there, life is only once, and we have to live that with happy pleasure. Fantastic way we have to live this life. So carry out whatever you want on this earth here only in order to get pleasure. So this is second school of thought. The first we have discussed Pratyakshavada, second Sukhavada, and third Jadavada. That means the materialistic world, everything is made up of matter, and follow this materialistic world. Don't go for ideology that is having soul, presence of God, spirit and all that. So this is basic ideology of Charvaka. This is obviously pre-Buddhist, because 8th century BC somewhere this ideology was there. So this is pre-Buddhist ideology. This is also called as Nastika, because the presence of these all Vedic concepts, they are not following 100%, and therefore this is called as Nastik ideology.